I just want to say, as a suicidal person, I am resentful of all the people that don't want to kill themselves, but they do nothing with their lives. How dare you not want to die and still manage to do nothing with your life? Let's talk to Q about something. I don't know what. Hi, everyone. Welcome back to today's podcast. My name is Brittany Simon. Today, my bestie Q is with me, and we're going to talk about something. He had me do some homework last night, so we'll see how it relates. I actually have no idea. In terms of tea, I am drinking from this cute-ass teapot, but I don't actually know the kind of tea that I'm drinking because it's the one my sister-in-law got me from a local tea shop. So I don't know what it is, but it's pretty darn good. I have a cold, so I can't really taste it that much, but I'm getting like hints of lemon. So something is in there that's potent like that. Are you drinking tea today, Q?
I'm drinking simple black out of a red.
Oh, okay. Interesting. A black tea. Your audio is cutting out a little bit, so I'm going to change that up if something goes up. So I just want to make sure you said something about red tea.
A red teapot.
Ooh, a red teapot. Very pretty. Okay, so what are we talking about today?
Well, I've been watching your videos recently, and I've been thinking about how you communicate with people and what people are talking about and what's going on, and just trying to think about what needs to be said or what can be said that isn't being said. And what I find missing in the conversation is, like, I think sometimes we're looking forward. We're talking about, you know, like, how should I live my life? What decision should I make? And so forth. And we're not necessarily looking backwards at, you know, like, what would help other people? What's going on with them? And the discussion with Abba was an interesting one because there was sort of a focus on his part on other people. Mm. And I know that often you don't want to tell other people what to do because that would be like telling them how to live their life. But I think there's room in here to address some things that maybe other people are doing that we just know are obviously wrong.
Okay.
And the main thing that came to mind is I think people are too fearful. Mm. I think the people are just afraid far too much. They're afraid of what other people are doing. They're afraid of themselves. They're afraid of limitations that they have. They're afraid of you know, how other people are going to think about them. So all of that talk that you might want to give someone of like, you know, go for it and be yourself and all that, I think they're afraid to.
Yeah.
And I wanted to sort of take some lenses to look at what people are afraid of and how that works and what maybe is keeping them back socially. And so that's where the homework came from. Hopefully it makes a little bit of sense.
No, it makes more sense now. And I actually, well, you know, I think that like the road to hell is paved in good intentions, but mostly it comes from a place of fear. Like good intentions come from a place of fear. And so I'm kind of like already on board with you. So I'm curious. So I did the homework. Yes, I read the two passages from Wizard of Oz and then I watched the clip.
Okay. Yeah. So Wizard of Oz is great. Have you watched the whole movie?
Hundreds of times. Mm-hmm.
Right. Have you ever read the book?
No.
Did you find it interesting to read parts of it?
Yeah, I thought the book was much more moving and less infantilizing than the movie.
Yeah, like infinitely less infantilizing. That, in fact, is really the whole point that I was trying to get at and that I wanted to sort of go through. I don't want this to just be me ranting about The Wizard of Oz. So, but one thing that I noticed was the book itself gives the reader an opportunity to see who these people are, like what their faults are and what their faults aren't. And it becomes very clear very quickly that the characters don't have the faults that they think they have. As you read through the scene, you see that the Scarecrow thinks he's not intelligent, but he's always solving problems. He's always coming up with clever tricks to use to fix the dilemmas that they're in. The Lion thinks that he's not courageous, but he's constantly, like, you know, defending Dorothy from the monsters or you know, like, doing brave things. Mm-hmm. He's the one who's ready to fight. And the Tin Woodsman, it's a little interesting how it's written. He thinks he doesn't have a heart, but he's unable to... He will cry if he steps on an insect. He is a complete vegetarian. He doesn't want anyone to suffer. And he wishes that he had a heart because he thinks that if he had a heart, that would automatically prevent him from causing suffering in the world. But he's just so tender-hearted that he can't hurt anyone. So they all are clearly shown in the book to not have the faults that they think that they have.
Yeah.
And then it's interesting how at the end it gets addressed. But we can just talk about that for a minute, because I think there's this thing that goes on in the world where people think that they have problems that they don't really have.
Yeah, okay. I'm so curious about this. Your audio is clipping out. It's almost like it's so trying not to get background noise that it's clipping off some of your words. So I don't know if you want to just, make it a little less sensitive. So when I was reading through last night, I didn't know the story of the Tin Woodsman in that context. Like, I didn't know that it chopped off his limbs. Like, I didn't process that as a child. At least, is that how it goes in the movie? Like, I don't even remember that from the movie. And I've seen that movie so many times. But I don't remember the concept that, like, he was trying to get married and he was trying to do this thing. But I think that that is what is happening, is that people don't know what they're capable of, or they don't even know they're already doing it. And so they sit there and think, like, I can't do this. But I'm like, you're already doing it. Like, you're already existing. You're already doing the basics. You're already going to work. So when people always doubt themselves, I think I'm shook. But I know I'm such a, like, I have such a large ego that I think my confidence is derived from my, like, my desire to challenge myself and to see what I'm capable of, so I know what I'm working with. But I have to test it. Like, I have this desire to test my limitations. And I find that other humans don't have that, even though they're more than capable. They're amazing. So why do you think that is?
Well, yeah. So to answer the question, no, that's not in the movie. There's so much that's in the story that never made it into the movie.
It's too bad.
And what did make it to the movie is giving all the wrong lessons, in fact. And it becomes, like, really horrifying towards the end. But, yeah, the book lesson is basically, he is this tender-hearted person, some bad things happen to him, but he's still, like, cheerful and going forward with his life as best he can. And he still, like, he wants to marry the Munchkin woman. And, you know, that's sort of a cross-species relationship there. but he has this sense of romance in his heart, but he's afraid. Like, you know, he, like a lot of other people, like the other characters, they just are afraid that they're not up to the task. And they basically ultimately want the wizard to tell them, no, you, I'm going to change you. I'm going to fix you. I'm going to solve your problems. But there's not much to solve. And, you know, not to trash the self-help guru market that you're in, but the self-help guru is in many times in a situation of telling people, no, you're fine. Like, just try. You go to a therapist and they just have to tell you, no, just give it a bit of thought. Mm-hmm. Like, I'll listen to you. I'll stay with you. I'll give you a chance to figure this out on your own. But you can do this.
Mm-hmm.
You can do this is really not a message that's out there in the world enough.
Right. Do you think that's why, like, even ABBA was so interesting, because I really liked our discussion, but the fact that he, like, doesn't participate in Canadian politics frustrates me a little bit, because when people rely on the system but then don't participate in the system, I'm like, then you are just relying on yourself, and therefore you are in agreement with me that it starts with us. Because if ABBA believed the system was going to impact his life, he would be a part of it. But he doesn't, because he knows he made it through life on his own. So he's either seeing himself as, like, an extreme exception, therefore I'm the exception, or he's just a normal person who did the things. Like, I don't know. I don't get it.
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely a small amount of hypocrisy there that is, you know, observable. I don't know that someone has to actively participate. Like, I don't know if you have to run for president in order to have an opinion about the government, but it does seem like you have to at least be informed. The thing that I do find missing from people who want someone else to do it is that they're not making enough, or maybe even they're making no effort to inform themselves. And so when the government comes along one day and, you know, has a bad solution or a bad plan, they just don't know any better. And they're sort of pushing everything off onto these people in power, expecting people in power to be noble and just, and basically expecting them to be like the Wizard of Oz. They're thinking, this is someone else who has the power. Someone else can do it. I don't know. I'm not smart enough. I can't understand these things. And they don't seem to want to grasp that the people in government are either more corrupt than them, or more vicious, or more something. You know, like, there's usually something that motivates someone to actually get into government that's not altruism. And therefore, it should be relatively easy to look at these people in power and say, maybe they're not doing the right thing. Maybe they should do this. Maybe they should do that. Or maybe I should put some ideas out there and use my platform to put forward real concrete notions that people can at least start thinking about. It doesn't have to be a full plan. It doesn't have to be a total solution, but more than nothing.
Well, I think that just like the Wizard of Oz isn't quite a wizard. People look to him as one just because of the way he arrived in Oz is how the story goes, I guess. So I'm thinking about this man who just arrived in a place and people worshipped him because he looked like he could be a leader. I think that's what people are doing out of fear. They're like looking to somebody else to be like, tell me what to do. I feel this anxiety sometimes where like people will look at me and be like, Brittany, tell me what to do. And I'm like, oh, you could just do what I did. No, I can't do that though. And I'm like, okay. So like, why are you asking me if you're not going to do it the way I did it? Because I only know how to do it the way I did it. Like, that's the only solution I have is the way I did it, because I don't know how other people are going to make it in a different way because I didn't do it that way. Right? So I think that that's also a problem, is that the fear makes them want to look to people, but they are looking maybe at the wrong places. Because like, the reason I always have an issue with like the coaches and the gurus is they tend to be a little too optimistic for me, like a little too like, you can do it. And I'm like, okay, you can do it with hard work. It might not go the way you want and it might not work out perfect, but there are things you can do in life. And the problem is, I know this always happens to me in discussions where people are like, well, Brittany, even if you work really hard, that doesn't mean you're going to get what you want. Yes, that is also a possibility. But if you don't do anything, you're still just beholden to the same possibilities, which is limited. If you go for it and fail, at least you know, like, but there are more options out there. I just know that for a fact. So it's almost ignorant of me to lie to them and kind of go along with their idea that like, what if still something will happen? Maybe it's not what you wanted, but maybe along the journey you pick up a tool for something better to happen. Or something worse. But I think that fear that's holding them back is also the same thing that's going to hold them back from the possibility of like taking that risk. Like, what's the point if you don't take some risk, right?
Yeah, and I think that's exactly the case, that when someone... before you've done something, you don't really know what it is that you want. And the process of getting there changes your perspective so much. So you think, you know, oh, I want to be able to play guitar, or I want to be able to like be a bodybuilder, like whatever it is, you know, be a carpenter, anything. You go down that path of developing those skills. And along the journey, you stop seeing what you thought was important as important. Like, you might think, oh, I want to play guitar so I can pick up chicks. And along the way, you realize that, oh no, I actually love the guitar. I love the intricacy, the complexity, the music. And whether or not you get a date out of it stops being important to you. And maybe some women come around and they're like, oh, you play guitar, that's so cool. And you're like, get away from me, I'm busy practicing. Like, your whole value system changes by the fact that you put the time and the effort into it. That one of the things that comes to mind when I think about you is the fact that you read a bunch of books. Like, I don't know why you read them, but I bet that what you got out of them ultimately was not necessarily what you thought you were going to get out of them, or what you hoped, but it gave you perspective and grounding and options and ways of thinking. It gives you a whole set of tools that enable you to think of entirely new things to start doing, go in different directions. Mm-hmm. So it's always useful to like put the effort in. And if you don't get what you want, you'll find that things still turn out pretty well, like the song says.
Yeah. When I read a lot, even like as a child, but then I went through this stage where I was like, I'm not reading anymore, from like 11 to 15. And my teacher handed me a book by Robert B. Parker, who's an author out of Massachusetts, who I love. And it like put me back into the reading thing. And so now I was reading like a book or two a day, and I was like consuming. And then I found a book by Laurel K. Hamilton, which introduced me to BDSM. And I was like, BDSM. And then all of a sudden, you know, 6 years later, I'm meeting real BDSMers and I'm in dungeons and I'm like, oh my God, this is real. And so what books gave me was a possibility into bubbles I didn't know I could explore, because I thought the world was just like Rush Limbaugh and fucking Sean Hannity. I don't know. And then books gave me like those tools. Yeah, without books, I just never would have become the person that I am. Like, there's just no way, because they were like portals into different worlds. They were just knowledge that other people had and were sharing, and trying to like send me the signal that like, hey, you have options. And I just didn't know I had those options. And so but reading was really hard. Actually, because of a book, my dad didn't talk to me for 2 years, because I brought home a book about a boy who falls in love with a lesbian. Like, a book caused my father to not talk to me for 2 years, which forced me as a teenager to start learning what like being the better, like not the bigger, but like not better, but bigger person was. Like, I remember in order for my father and I to start talking again, my teacher told me I have to apologize to him. I was like, but he's the adult. And he's like, yeah, but think about all the books you've read. Think about all the characters. Think about all the children who have to overcome adult stubbornness. This is your opportunity to be less stubborn than the adult. And so I went and I apologized. And it was one of those things that, yeah, like my dad and I started talking and we fixed our relationship. But even to this day, I can see myself parenting my parents. And I don't think I would have known how to do that if I didn't read the books and have the teacher who helped me form those thoughts and like bring them into real life. Because I would see people in stories figuring out these conflicts. But in your head, you're thinking, oh, it's just fictional. I can't do that. But no, like you very much, like books are written by real people and real people are really writing about their experiences. So they are happening. So yeah, without books, I just don't know how I would have been in any way functional the way I am now.
Yeah, you got on that books to bondage pipeline there.
That should be, I gotta put that on merch, books to bondage. But yeah, that is truly what happened. Reading got me into bondage, without a doubt. Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's definitely the case that there's so much that people can do once they try.
Yes.
It's not easy. You know, people watch a YouTube video or, you know, a TV show or whatever it might be, and they always make it look trivial. They always make it look like, you know, oh, yes, you go practice for 5 minutes and now you're the star baseball player. And that's not real. And it sets people up for failure to show them these ideas that make it seem like it's that simple. There's not enough out there that's telling people, no, it's effort. Like you're going to spend time. You're going to maybe get calluses, or you're going to, you know, have sleepless nights or whatever it's going to be. It's not easy, you know, this road to self-improvement on multiple layers. But once you get down it a little ways, you realize that you want to keep going. You start to see, you know, it's like with exercise, you start to see the benefits of it and you want to keep doing it. And you realize this is fun. I like this. And yes, it's going to take time. But the fact it takes time is part of what's wonderful about it. It means that there's always more to do. There's always room for improvement, always new things to learn.
There's this meme on Twitter that's been going around, or at least that's where I've seen it, where it's like, hey guys, I hate to say it, but I've been doing yoga for 30 minutes every morning. And yes, my mental health has improved. I'm sorry to say, this is the answer. You have to exercise. Like, you have to do the things. And it's like, I think it's hilarious, but I think it's so important to recognize, yes, I hate to say it, but the basics are the answer. You have to eat and sleep and you have to exercise and you have to really do it. You can't pretend to go to the gym and pretend to work out. You actually have to work out for it to actually improve your life. And there is no easy solution. Like, there is no go to a plastic surgeon and get me 6-pack abs and a big fatty and then call it a day. Like, you actually have to work for that fatty and work for those abs to actually reap the benefits of the exercise and the adrenaline and those good hormones pumping through your body. So I think like that is what I have mastered, like, in an amateur way, like that idea of radically accepting that, fuck, the answer is the hard stuff. Like, the answer is the suffering. The answer is the difficulty. Even now, like, the things I want the most, I have to work so hard to get them, but that's what makes it so worth it. And so it feels so much more special. I don't know how to explain it. Which is not to say, and I think this is what happens, people hear that and they go, so I need to fight through toxic relationships to have a good one, or I need to have a shitty life to have a good, like, no. Like, don't make your life shitty to have a good one. But in life, you have to sacrifice, or life is hard, in order to get the things that are worth it. Like, good relationships, like friends. Like, Abba was saying, well, I'm not going to maintain friends that live in the same city as me. Then you're not willing to work hard enough to create long-lasting, loyal bonds. Because if proximity to, like, you is what, like, explains it. I don't know. It's just not that to me is not, then that's, it's not real. It's just, it's kind of shallow, but maybe not. Maybe some brains are so specifically different. Maybe for him, it has to be within close proximity. But then for me, like, then that's not a forever friend. That's just somebody that's good for now, which is fine. But then that's different than talking about being seen and having good lasting relationships. And you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. Well, there was part of what Abba was saying that is obviously, like, some of the arguments that Abba used, or some of the ways that he presented himself, I felt were disingenuous. Like, he was making a point that, don't you think that, you know, being near people is different than being seeing them online? Well, no shit. Yeah, of course it is. But that doesn't mean that your criteria for who's going to be important and special in your life should be, are they within the range that I can throw a small rock? Like, the fact that they're nearby should not necessarily make them your friend. even though having your friends nearby is better than having them far away.
Yeah.
It would be great if you and I were closer physically so that we could go to the mall and be cool and hang out and get coffee or something. But the fact that we're not doing that doesn't get in the way. Like that,
no.
It's not as good, yes, but our lives are still just great and we are great friends and we don't need to like say, oh, well, you know, you don't live next door anymore, therefore I can't talk to you. Like there's just something about that that's weird. And it's weird, like it would be weird for me to go up to someone and say, hey, you live near me, let's be friends.
Yeah. Yeah. No, okay. I think it gets down to like, I don't know if I'm romanticizing it too much, but like I love the consciousness that is Q. Like no one can be Q. So why would I choose? Like, it's not a matter of choosing just anyone to be my friend. I'm choosing specifically you. And I'm asking you, can you be my friend? Do you want to be like someone I know until the day I die? Like, I'd really like that. You know what I mean? But that's because of you. Like, I cannot replace you. Right. And so I think for maybe other people, maybe they think they can replace people. And yes, I can replace shallow friends every day with new people. But that's the point, is I'm distinguishing out loud that I am putting my, I'm investing in you, and that it's kind of scary in some ways because like I let you into my life, you know my family, you know everything about me. Like do you want to talk about trust? I do trust you. Like I'd give you everything about me to enable, like I would let you destroy me if you thought it was for my betterment because I assume you know something I don't know. But that's the thing, is I didn't just form that out of nowhere. I didn't just pick you out of nowhere. You know, we had to build that bond and I had to, you know, we had to do something to get it, right? I don't know exactly what, if you had to pinpoint it, but I mean, you've been there for me through a lot, right? And so that helps. But I think that's what it is I am like, I love the consciousness that is you. And so asking me to replace you is like devastating to me.
Yeah. Yeah. It's very strange. And when I look at the other side of it, the idea that you like, I'm not actually attacking ABBA or friendships. I'm sure that they're good.
Right.
But there's just this superficial understanding of it that I have, which is you make friends because they're in the same place as you. Maybe they play on the same like little sports team that you play on, or they're in your community. And then suddenly you feel that you're trapped and you don't want to leave town because this is where your friends are. But it's still these shallow friendships,
yeah,
or potentially shallow friendships. And so you're not, you're on the one hand trapping yourself, and on the other hand, you're not finding something deeper, maybe.
Yeah, no, my mom always said, one thing I will give my parents major, major credit for is they never made us feel guilty for leaving, for starting our own lives, for doing anything that made sense to us, like as independent people. They wanted their kids to be independent. And my mom would always say like, you know, distance makes the heart grow fonder and I love you and I need you. Go travel, go to anywhere, go see the world because you know I'll love you no matter where you are. That, it was so reassuring to me. But I know my friends and family, like some people I know, they would be like, well, if I left town, then like I know my relationships are going to like lose connection. And I'm like, that sucks that you have friends that, I don't know, like it's, I guess like that's why I think I have to distinguish who's important, because like even my friends in Seattle, even though we can't be inner circle for each other because we don't have the spoons and we've chosen other people, they're so close to me that it doesn't matter that I haven't seen them for 3 years. They're so eager to see me. I'm eager to see them. We talk every 2 months on, you know, Zoom or Skype or whatever, but like we make an effort because for all of Seattle, those two people that I love more than anything, I am so grateful, I think, that they continue to choose me as a friend, even though we know we might not, who knows how long it will last. You know, we don't know. You know, with you, I just like put in the back of my head that we're going to know each other till I die. And that's that. Like, I never think or question it because we've made that commitment, I guess. But like, I don't even know how we made it, except that we chose it. I don't know. Like, it just, I don't even know how to explain why I picked you specifically over other people. It's just like, for whatever reason, maybe you see more of me. But that's what I'm saying. How can you throw that away? Like, how could you get something so special and then throw it away? But maybe they haven't had it. That's my other thing. Maybe they haven't had it. Maybe they haven't had a cue.
Yeah, it's definitely possible. Like, who knows? Like, I hate speculating about other people.
Yeah, of course.
When we're talking about individuals. Because it is so unknown. And like, I'm sure that everyone has someone important to them in their life and that person's gone away from them. And maybe it turned out well, maybe it didn't. I think that part of it's easy for us because we're distant. Like there's a point where if you have a relationship with someone and they're far away, well, what more can go wrong? I mean, short of one of us getting on a spaceship and traveling, you know, to Mars, you know, we're not going to be out of touch very much.
Yeah. Yeah. And also, somebody said like, oh, I think Brittany's job is the, like the privilege where she gets to stay in contact with people. But like, even when I work two jobs or whatever, I was still staying in touch with people because I make the effort to not eat or not sleep in order to contact people. So yeah, sometimes I even do it to my own detriment where like Sundays are my catch up with everyone days. And that can be a lot of like, that can be quite a lot because there's a lot of people who like want to contact me. I know when my partner came into town to meet my siblings, I woke up to like 30 text messages from people who were like, oh, call me, tell me how it was, call me. That's intimidating and a lot. And I had to choose like who gets priority, who gets to be told the story first, because who's like the closest to my life, like who's going to be impacted the most? Well, my sister, because like, you know what I mean? If we get married, then like, well, he's now her brother-in-law. So she gets priority over that conversation. And then you, obviously, because I'm like, oh, you're going to have to meet and you're going to have to talk and you're going to have to socialize because like, you know what I mean? He's going to have to get along with the people in my life that I've picked, hopefully. And so it is kind of interesting, but it's not to say that my other friends don't or aren't important. It's just that like, yeah, I have to pick and choose all the time with my spoons, but that's why I put everyone in hierarchies. So I know who I'm obligated to because I want to be obligated to them. Loyalty is like really important to me, which allows me to move through the fear of feeling like I'm giving too much or feeling like they could abandon me. It actually allows me to allow them space to abandon the friendship, which puts my fear at ease, going back to what we were talking about with fear. But in some ways, like my sister, because we're so strongly bonded, I would trust her to come to me and say, I need space from you for 6 months and to understand why she needs that space. Versus with another friend, maybe if I was ruled by the fear that they would abandon me, maybe I wouldn't allow them that space to be free. And so they would feel suffocated by me and then leave because they were afraid.
Yeah, yeah, that is the toxic pattern. Mm-hmm. It's interesting how doing things, you know, the good way, or when things go well, it's a reinforcing pattern that makes things get better and better. And when things are not good, they get worse and worse. There's something very interesting about the way that life plays out that makes it such that if you just start doing the good things a little bit, then suddenly everything gets better and easier. And that's one of the things I wanted to say a minute ago. You were talking about how, you know, you want to do the hard stuff or do what, you know, the dangerous stuff or so forth. But the reality is it's not that hard and not that dangerous. Mm. Like from the perspective of when you aren't doing it, you think, oh, exercise is going to be difficult or yoga is going to be difficult or whatever. You start down the path and you realize, no, this isn't. And there's a certain wisdom of, you look around in the world and you see humans are doing these things. Like just normal humans are doing these things. It can't be that hard. People aren't that magical. They're not that different. If someone else can do it, you can do it. You know, most of the time, you can at least give it a shot and see how it turns out. And it won't break you to try. You know, if someone else eats a food, you can probably try it. You know, I'm not saying you need to or you have to or it's always the right decision, but things are usually just not that difficult. And that's one of the nice lessons, again, in the book, Wizard of Oz. In the book, Dorothy shows up and instantly kills a witch. Doesn't even try. Just drops a house on her. Like, what could be easier? And then she goes on these adventures and she's constantly meeting people who help her. There's the main characters that she runs into who help her, but also lots of other people that she meets are very nice. And they're just friendly and they help out and they try to solve problems. And she rapidly discovers that in the world, not everyone is trying to kill you. It's not that bad. It's kind of funny. In the film version, the Wicked Witch immediately is there at the beginning and is the antagonist. In the book version, the Wicked Witch doesn't show up as an antagonist until Dorothy goes out to kill her.
Oh!
Like, Dorothy is the initiator of this action. She's going out on a deliberate mission to kill the Wicked Witch. Whereas in the movie, they made it some kind of defensive, like she's an innocent person who's being forced into this situation. And she doesn't want to kill her. Like she, you know, she's not an evil person. It's similar to the movie. She's been sent on a mission by the Wizard of Oz. But she's going out and she's doing her quest and she's doing her thing. And she's, you know, taking control of her destiny. And the other people around her are helping her out. And it all just kind of works out, though, because very, very similar to the movie, she accidentally throws water on the Wicked Witch. Mm. And she doesn't know that water will hurt her. So that was similar. But in the movie, they made it even more of an accident. And it just shows that, you know, it's trying to say that things can go well without you necessarily knowing what you're doing. Just like give it an effort and see how things turn out, and you can be surprised how good your life is.
Okay, that's, that coincides with a few things I'm thinking of. Luck, which we've talked about recently in the last few weeks, which not everyone feels like they have. I don't really identify with that idea, but I'm sure it is lucky that I've ended up where I am. In relation to like those tiny, tiny contradictions in life that coincide together, it is very easy and it is very hard, right? I see this like with certain moral questionable things that show up. I think of cheating right away. Whereas, like, in some ways, be devastated you were cheated on, cry about it, call that person the devil, but then get over it, bro. They had sex with someone else. You can survive this. Like, it's not that big of a fucking deal. I just saw this, like, dating show, and this guy, like, harbored so much anger over his ex cheating on him and getting pregnant with this new guy that he, like, brought it into his new relationship. And I'm like, it's not that deep, bro. But then I remember what it was like being cheated on, and I know it's devastating. It's the most hurtful thing. It, like, shatters your whole illusion of that person. And I think it's hard to stay with that person after they've cheated. But at the end of the day, relax. Okay? They put their genitals in someone else's genitals. Like, it's not even that big of a deal. But it is. And those tiny contradictions have to coincide and live together. You have to be able to say, going to the gym is easy, but it's also really fucking hard to get out of my house. So I understand that it's going to be both of those things, but it is quite easy. Like, that's what I tell myself when I'm like, just do a push-up. I'm like, I hate doing a push-up. It's so hard. I'm like, just do one push-up. Oh, look, two push-ups. Oh, look, three push-ups. Five push-ups. That's like, you know, that's usually my goal, but if like, it sounds so hard just to do one. So I think like you have to acknowledge one for the other, which is why that balance has to come in. But I do think that that is all of life. All of life is like, oh, I have to make money to buy a house. I'm exhausted by this process. And I also know it's easy to make money. All I have to do is take more callers. But psychologically, I run out of spoons, so I can't take more callers, which means I don't have the money. Even though it's very easy to make the money, I just have to take callers. But why can't I even take callers? Because I'm tired. And so like, it's this cycle of like, oh my God. And so then I have to realize, well, you know, if you sleep more, you could have more energy to take more callers. But sleeping is hard because then I have to stop thinking. And if I stop thinking, then what if I don't problem solve enough for tomorrow? And then it's just like this loop, and then all of a sudden you haven't done anything.
Yeah, no, you hit upon it. And that's all fine. Like, that's the normal reality of dealing with stressful situations. And even then, like, if you just took more callers and you didn't sleep enough and think enough, then maybe you stop providing the value to the callers that you want to provide. True. Which might ultimately mean you get no callers, or it might just mean you feel bad about yourself. But, you know, it's not what you want to do. So it's very difficult to make, quote unquote, the right decisions, because most of our decisions in life are trade-offs. Like, even if you decide, I'm going to go exercise, I'm going to do the push-ups, well, you're not practicing guitar now. Like, oh, well, okay, I'll go practice guitar. Well, then you're not doing the yoga. Like, you can't do it all at once. Everything takes time. You have limited energy and resources. That is the hard part. The hard part is managing your time and just feeling confident in yourself and accepting the fact that you're not making perfect decisions, accepting the fact that you're slowly becoming the person that you're becoming, and that's who you're going to be. And you have some influence over it, not complete control.
Yeah.
And but all I would say to people is, do what you can. Like, don't leave it up to other people. Don't just look at, you know, whether it be the government or your parents or whoever, don't just look at other people and think, well, they'll do it for me. They'll solve the problems. I don't have to do anything. I'll just play some video games. Not that there's anything wrong with video games, but it's, you know, one of those escapes that people go to where they're avoiding something that they know is, or at least they think is, harder.
Yeah, it's like, goes back to that cope conversation that I had with Steven and Abba about, like, you know, should we blame the copes, like the sex workers and the video games and the drugs, or should we blame society, or maybe parents, or maybe, since we can't tell parents how to be, like, we can't genuinely, and I don't think we should, you know, think about, we shouldn't even cross the barrier of going into parents' homes and being like, raise your kids this way. No, just, okay, write some books and people will read it or they won't. And that's the dilemma, is that I don't think you can move society in a direction. I think you can... Well, I think you can to some extent, but it's just, it depends on how we want to do things. And I know America has a very specific mindset about how we think about our freedoms, but it is like the wild, wild west, which means it's going to be hard. And I think that it's easier than the wild, wild west and hard all the same in our own bubble here. So I think, like, I don't want to tell people life is easy, But I want to tell people that the solutions for life are easy in the sense that it's all been written about. I feel like all the answers are already out there. We just have to decide how to utilize them. And if you look like, if you ask Brittany, me, like, how did you end up finding your joy? Well, I kind of like did the basics. And I hate to say it, but it kind of worked. And then outside of the basics, like, I understand, like, if I lose my job tomorrow, yeah, I'm back to square one again. And I have to remake my wealth, which sucks. Like, that sounds awful. I don't want to do that. But I also know that that could happen. Because that's life. Like, no one is guaranteed consistent work. No one's guaranteed consistent family. No one's guaranteed anything. Because we share a planet with a bunch of people who are making decisions outside of us. And so we're just impacted by the reality. And that's what's hard. But also, if you're lucky enough to navigate your life in a certain way, you can be pretty happy with basically nothing. You can be happy with basically a farm or land, I should say, and your family. But you might not even have the resources that, you know, totally accessible to you. What I'm trying to say is that it is all of these things. And so with that in mind, it's easier to play the game because you know that we're all struggling and you know that we all have different versions of it. So it's like, great, then I'll just work within the rules of what I've been given and then maybe break a couple along the way.
Yeah, I know what you're saying. Well, once you have a certain understanding of the way the world is, then it's much easier to accept the hard times, the difficult things that happen and the things that are outside your control, because you know that, yeah, that's just the way it is sometimes. Mm-hmm. And when I have good times, I'll appreciate them. And I will know that a certain amount of this is just luck. And it's not that I don't deserve it. Yeah, I put some effort in. You know, like, I got some of the, I did what people can do to get good things to happen. And so I deserve this a little bit. But I don't have a magic ability to make this happen. You know, I need to be grateful for when good things happen, because bad things can also happen. You know, there could be a traffic accident tomorrow. You know, like, any bad thing can come along that I can't prevent. But I'm not going to make my life better if I'm afraid of all those things. And if I hide in my house, that's not going to be better. And, you know, regarding the copes, so I think that all the copes should be there. Like, I may have said this before, but, you know, I'm for legalizing everything, making everything possible, sex, drugs, rock and roll, gambling, everything. You know, let people have the things that they want to have, that they're going to do anyway, and make it as safe and legal and friendly and, you know, as Disney as possible. You know, like the Disney heroin camp should be a great place to go. Take the ride.
I just imagine somebody with Mickey's voice being like a woo. Okay, I'm on board.
So, you know, I'm for all of that, and let all the copes exist, because that is part of, like, how people deal with the stress of life. Is you go out, you work hard, and then you get tired and you go play some video games, or you go hire a prostitute. You do whatever you're going to do, and then you go on with your life, and the coping was part of it. It's just like sleeping. It's just like everything else. And if you manage it poorly, then bad things happen. But if you manage your work life poorly, then your relationships suffer. There's all sorts of ways to ruin your life doing good things along the way.
Mm-hmm. I was just thinking about, I had a friend who, like, was married, and his wife one day woke up and said, I'm going to go, like, teach kids in this country how to speak English. And he was like, we're married. And she was like, yeah, I know, but I'm going to stop being married to you so I can go do this. And he was like, okay. And, like, it kind of was more detailed than that. But basically, yeah, she had this, like, awakening one day where she's like, I should help children in X country. And so I'm going to dissolve this marriage to go do it. And I'm like, whoa, like, that is, like, a good deed. But look at the way you just fucked up your whole marriage and, like, tortured your husband basically out of a life he thought he was going to have with you. Isn't that interesting? Like, in some ways, it's like, oh, that's such a beautiful, selfless thing. But it was kind of selfish of you to, like, ditch your marriage for this. So I think it would have been better if she just said, I'm done with the marriage. Oh, and I'm actually going to do this with my single life. Versus, like, the way she phrased it, the way that it was communicated to me, almost sounded like she chose, like, this great deed at the expense of her marriage. And I was like, that's weird. So, you know, that whole idea, like, the road to hell is paved in good intentions, I think it comes from this fear that I might not be doing enough, or this fear that I could save the homosexuals if I just, like, give them conversion therapy. You know what I mean? And so in those moments, it is kind of funny how many good deeds, while they aren't that good.
Yeah. Oh, I can't help but think also that that good deed might just be, that colonizer drive needing to get out there.
Honestly, though, a little bit that whiteness showing through. I'm not even gonna pretend otherwise. No, I think that's a big part of it, if I'm being real. The savior complex is huge in people, and I think like that is the biggest part of it. But you know what's funny is like I do hear, I think I lose my sympathy, not for people who are trying. Though my VC just had a discussion with me where they feel like everything a person is doing is exactly what they can do, which is true. Like, take your time, but do it now. It's like, you don't have to rush. Nothing matters, but like, do it now. It's for your own sake. You're going to do it now. Not for society's. Fuck the world. I'm not telling you to do something because it's morally right. I'm telling you to do something for your own fucking benefit. Work out for your own fucking benefit. Like, start saving your money for your own benefit. Be selfish. Be so selfish that you are successful and now you can help other people. But they can't, you have to see it. You have to like flip perspective on its side and keep flipping it around until it clicks in your brain of this is why I'm doing it. And also, I just want to say as a suicidal person, I'm resentful of all the people that don't want to kill themselves, but they do nothing with their lives. How dare you not want to die and still manage to do nothing with your life? Like, I fucking hate those people, considering that like the only reason I'm doing anything with my life is because I'm like, or I could die, but I can't justify killing myself unless I try my hardest to make sure that I'm not wanting to kill myself because of circumstance, which it is, by the way. Society is the reason I want to kill myself. It's never because I want to die. It's because you all make it so fucking hard on me that now I feel like I'm pushed into a corner. I'm like, I'm just going to die. Because you're not letting me do the sex work I want. You're not letting me do the drugs I want. You're not letting me live my life, have the babies. Like, you know, every time someone says, Brittany doesn't deserve to have a life, I'm like, great, then let me kill myself. No. Not only am I going to let you not have the life you want, but I'm also not going to let you kill yourself. Y'all are just trying to torture this bitch. That's what it feel like.
Yeah, there's a certain, there's a lot to be said for the ability to have those perspectives. Not necessarily that it's the mentality you want to live in every moment of the day, but it's good to be able to visit them, good to be able to like question like what's going on and what other people's incentives are, like why do they want that, do they really understand you, do they really care about you, do they really understand themselves, what. So it goes back, so I want to get back to the book,
please,
and the book and the movie, because there is this thing that when people talk about, you know, society, I think about, well, what did society do to this book when they made this movie? Because you can see certain things happened, and you can see the things that society does when it's trying to take a good message and give it to people, and how it becomes a bad message. One thing I'll throw in, and I'm apologies to anyone if I'm spoiling an old book, but the Emerald City in the movie is real. Like, you go and you see the Emerald City, and it's a pretty place and all these things. In the book, it's fake. So in the book version, when you go to the Emerald City, at the door, you're required to put on green-colored goggles that are locked onto your head so you can't remove them. And then you go into the Emerald City, and everything is magically green. Everything is emeralds. It's like, and the wizard basically explains to people that if you saw the emeralds directly, it would be blinding to you. So you need to be protected by wearing these green goggles. And, of course, the point is that it's all fake. Like, yeah, everything in the Emerald City is actually just normal. There's no Emerald City. There are no emeralds. It's just a place where people look through green glass. And they don't know they're being tricked, but they're sort of participating in it. And it's a nice enough city. Like, everyone's happy enough with it. But it's all fake. And there's this kind of message in the book, which is... And it's not told to the reader. The reader isn't told, hey, it's all fake. Feel bad about it. Get angry. The reader is just allowed to understand this. Mm-hmm. The book presents no value judgment on it. The book doesn't present any value judgments. It's all left up to the reader to like come to these conclusions themselves. Like, that's in fact part of the great structure of the book, is it's letting the reader do the work. It's not doing it for them. But it's letting the reader see that you can't necessarily trust people. You can't necessarily trust the government, you know, the wizard. Like, the things that they're telling you aren't necessarily true. Your Emerald City isn't necessarily emeralds. You should doubt and you should question. You should wonder what goggles you're looking through, wonder how you're getting your information. That, I mean, it's a nice message. But when it gets transferred to the movie, of course they don't do that. They would think of how absurd and silly it would be and how it wouldn't even work because, like, I can forgive it, this, because it's a visual thing. Like, you couldn't... if you showed all the characters looking through green goggles, but you yourself were seeing that everything wasn't green, then the effect doesn't work. And if the camera shows everything green, then you can't see that it's fake. So I can forgive that. But let's get to the other part that I find unforgivable. So the characters, you know, you have the Scarecrow, the Woodsman, and the Lion. And Scarecrow wants brains, and the Woodsman wants heart, and the Lion wants courage. Now, in the book, it's very clear that they already have these things. And so when they get to the wizard basically is saying to them, you know, the thing you think you want, you don't really want, and what you already have is really good. Like, he tells the Scarecrow, you don't need brains, you have experience. Like, you're out there doing things, you're out there learning, you're getting what you need to get. And the Lion basically says, you know, I go into these, you know, he's talking to the Lion. Yeah, I'm making it sound a little different than the actual text, obviously. But the Lion's kind of saying, you know, I feel fear. Like, you know, I get into these situations and I want to be brave, but I feel fear. And the wizard says, but you overcome your fear. You go and you do that courageous thing, even though you feel afraid. That's real courage. And Lion basically says, yeah, but I'd rather just not feel fear. Like, I want the kind of courage where I just never feel afraid at all.
Yeah.
And they don't understand that what they're asking for isn't even good. Like, they're asking for something that's the wrong thing to want. They're wanting improperly. They're aiming at the wrong target, as Peterson would say. And then the wizard in the book basically just gives them some crap. Like, it's great because it's a point in the story where they know he's a fake wizard, and they want the things anyway.
Yeah.
Like, they know he's just this trickster. And so he's like, okay, fine, I'll give you some brains, I'll give you some stuff. And he gives them stuff that's nothing.
Like a placebo, basically.
Just total placebos. Like, he just stuffs some stuff in the Scarecrow's head. And he cuts a hole in the Tin Man and puts a heart inside him and patches him up. And, you know, he just gives the Lion something to drink and says, here, this will make you feel better. It basically gives him booze. And that's all fine. Like, they're fake tricks, and he gives them to him. And he says, basically to the reader, he kind of says, I'm giving them these things because they're demanding that I give them something. And who am I to deny them something that they think will make them happy, even though I know I'm doing absolutely nothing? Interesting message, good perspective to get. The movie version is horrifying. Now, what did you think of the movie version?
God, it, like, missed the mark, huh? Like, when he gave the Lion, like, the medal, and I was like, the medal's not the point! The medal's, like, the shallow version of the point. It was, like, offensive. Or, like, oh, here's an honorary degree. And I'm like, okay, the degree, also the superficial answer. And then, what did he give the other one? I actually don't remember. Wait, the degree, the medal.
He gives him a basically a little plastic heart with a clock in it. But it's what he tells the Tin Woodsman that's probably the worst possible thing that you could tell anyone.
Go, you have a better memory.
What? So, the Tin Woodsman wants a heart because he wants to love and feel kindness for other people and all this stuff. And in the movie, the wizard says to him, remember, and I might not get this exactly right, but he says something like, remember, it's not important whether or not you love other people and you're kind to them. It's important whether or not other people love you.
No. That's so bad.
That's the message for all three of them. So for the Scarecrow, it's, oh, you don't need a brain. There's all sorts of people in universities that are stupid, but what they have that you don't is a diploma.
Yeah.
So you need a diploma so you can be yet another one of these brainless people with a piece of paper that says you're intelligent. And he hands it to him, and he immediately says, you know, the Pythagoras theorem. And it's supposed to sound smart, but it's not real smart. It's not useful. It's just like this fake book learning that impresses people and means nothing. And it's really denigrating the idea of intelligence. And then he goes to the Lion and says, you know, what they have, you know, no one is brave. No one's courageous, but what they have that you don't is a medal. And so that they can go and they can march in parades and pretend that they did something brave. Never mind what a horrifyingly bad message that is towards, you know, servicemen with medals.
Yeah.
To just sort of say, you know, it's all fucking bullshit and they have medals, but they're not brave people.
Right.
It's just so horrifying to say that you only need the recognition for things. You don't need to do things. You don't need to have things. that you just need, you need the love of other people and you need medals and diplomas. It's terrible.
But you know what? It was I think it's a really good example of what society is aiming for, right? It's not that I have to produce good content. I just have to get the right amount of clicks. It's not that I need to produce, you know, anything of quality or have a good family or be a good partner. It's just that I need to have a partner and I need to have a family. And it's like, bros. So again, it's that superficial. I'm so shook that the book was so different and the way that it explained these things, like the lesson was so differently learned in both of them. And I was like, oh my, because I really loved that movie growing up, but now I would absolutely refer to the book over the movie. And I haven't even, I should go back and read the whole thing. But obviously the lessons are different and it's the difference is the difference. So when we have these, So when we have these conversations and I say things like the perspective is what matters, because you're looking at it from one is like this wholesome, great, like honorable version. And the other one is this shallow, just get it done. At least I can say I have it, which where's the quality in that? Where's like the introspective, like depth in that, right? And so that's how I see all of society. When I see them come to these conclusions, and I'm like, that is a conclusion on the surface level bubble reasoning that you're creating, and I accept it as like, fine. But there's another answer, and the other answer is harder. It is more complex, but it is also more rewarding. And so if your goal is to actually be introspective and be fulfilled, then you have to do the thing called discipline, which forces you to then sacrifice, which is the hard part. And people just don't want to do that because it is hard and that's fine, which is why I say I radically accept the world for what it is. And it is what it is because everyone participates in this bubble, like in the bubble, which is like the universe, right? So I can't be mad at the world for wanting the medal, wanting the diploma without wanting the depth. Because for them, they're going to get the thing they want, which is the likes. But for some of us, for the seldom few of us, I think there's more that we desire. And that more creates that, like, the desire to want to withstand the suffering. Like, the suffering becomes worth it. Because for me, suffering in mediocrity, like mediocrity? How do you say it?
Mediocrity.
Yeah. Suffering in that is worse to me than sacrificing and working harder because the reward is so much better because of what I want. Like what I need. Maybe it's a need over a want though. Maybe most people don't need more depth, but I need it because my pride won't let me have something otherwise.
I think you need it once you learn that you can have it. I think it's like with this movie and book.
Yeah.
When all you have is the movie and you look at it and it's a beautiful musical and everyone tells you it's the best movie ever made and it's a technological marvel and all these things and it's fun and you watch it yourself and you enjoy it and there's the songs and the colors and so pretty and delightful and you can look at it and you can think, this is great. I'm happy. I got the movie. I had the experience. Everything's done. But then you find out about the book and you're like, oh, wow, there's so much more in the book. And yeah, the book doesn't have singing. The book doesn't transition into full Technicolor partway through. The book doesn't have a lot of things that the movie does, but it has this other kind of depth that once you realize that you can have that, then you want both. And it's like, oh, I saw this new movie. Is there a book? Is there a novel I can read? Or I read this novel. Are they going to make it into a movie? Like, I want everything. I need all of it.
No, you're absolutely right. Because if I think back to when I was, you know, what I call a two, or if I was in my bubbles, I really thought I was, and I was technically only working with what I had. But when I knew that, so when I started off as a conservative and I was like, this is the answer. But then I found out other people were like living BDSM poly lives and it was making it work. I was like, well, if it works, then this can't be the answer. So let's look for a different answer. Maybe it's poly people. Maybe they have the answer. Okay, like poly isn't an answer. Poly is just a lifestyle. Okay, hold on. So maybe this has the answer. And then I kept going through and going through. And even in Seattle, when I was working two jobs and I was literally like, I was such a mess. I was like, what a mess Brittany was. I really thought this was like what I had to work with. And that's it. And it was very like scary. It was very much like white supremacy and colonization is like killing POCs and like the queer people aren't going to make it and women don't get anything in this country. And it was like a lot of like, and it can feel that way. Like it can. But then when I realized I could have something different and I could work within the same bubble, the same world I was in, I could just like do it different based off of me. Well, then I knew I was capable and then everything became an option. But you know what? It didn't start off with knowing I had all the options. I think it started off with knowing that everything was a construct to a certain extent. Like humans are doing their best and this is the world we were given. but we're no different or special than past generations. I think the thing that really gets to me is when people say, like, we're in 2022. So this is, like, we shouldn't even be having these discussions. But that's not how humans work. And it's not how humans are around the world. And if you say that in America, then you are saying that America is a great place. So we should be in this great place. So it's not this evil place that you think it is. But then the rest of the world that we uphold is kind of this evil place then? Because, like, those places are suffering with human rights and human, like, accessibility to, like, healthcare and bodily autonomy. So they're also suffering. So then nobody is any better than anyone else. And so then we are just, like, it doesn't matter what bubble you're born into. We all have struggles. So if that's the case, then okay, then none of it matters. And I just have to operate within the means of my, like, ability, within my means. And then in that case, it does fall on me in the end. It just sucks that sometimes people have power over your life. Like, I read this horrible story this morning. I'm really upset about prisons. You know I hate prisons. But, like, women give birth in prisons. They get to hold their babies. And then those babies, if they have no family, get put up for adoption. And it's just, like, horrible. And that happens here. A lot of bad things happen in America. But, like, a lot of bad things happen everywhere. And so I get angry emotionally. I'm, like, so upset. But then my brain is, like, avoid prison at all costs. But then what if somebody I know gets put into prison falsely, which happens, and it's happened to somebody in my family? It's like, well, what do we do now? You have to decide if you're going to spend your life advocating for that person or not. Funny enough, no one in my... No, they did fight for my cousin, but, like, you can't get him out because the law is just the way it is. Like, it is the way it is. But then if that was me in there, why do I have this feeling that my mom would be there every day protesting? I feel like my mom would contact everyone she had in her arsenal to get me on the news, right? I feel that way because I know my parents have done stuff like that in the past. So why is it my parents, I feel like, would do that for me, but I know, like, for my cousin, they can't. Even though they should be able to, is it that people give up? Like, if my sibling was in prison, I don't think I could ever give up. But maybe that's because of the way I think about them. Like, I feel about them. If it was my sibling's friend, I would care less. Right?
Right.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, there's a lot to unpack there. It's definitely the case that you have more ability to do things for people who are closer to you. Like, there's just part of it is, at least I'll talk about myself, you get more energy to do something for someone that you really care about. And so you can go harder. You can stay awake longer, you know, like physically do more, like whatever it is, you can do more than for some random stranger who you don't know. Like we as creatures cannot throw, and you see people try to do this. You see people who are throwing their lives away, desperately trying to change the world for people that they don't know and for circumstances they don't understand. And they achieve very little because everyone looks at them and it looks irrational. It looks insane.
Yeah.
If you see someone doing something for someone they care about, you understand it. Like, you can relate to it. It makes sense. When you see someone doing something seemingly unrelated, like they just go, they go hold a sign on the street and they say, free such and such a person. And they don't know that person and you don't know that person. It's like, why?
Yeah.
Like, you don't know them. How do I know? Why should I believe you that they should be free as opposed to all of society that put them in jail? Like, maybe society's right.
Mm.
And if someone, like, you know, I think about, you say, like, how terrible it is that the child gets put up for adoption. It's a question of, like, what was your baseline? Was the alternative that they keep the child in prison? Is that right, better? Right. Was the alternative that the child dies? Is that better? I mean, to some degree, I look at him like, that's a pretty good outcome. Child winds up with a good family, hopefully. Like, it was unfortunate that they got pregnant in prison, but then what? Like, what can we do? We can't just say, oh, well, anytime someone gets pregnant in prison, we'll just release them and give them $1 million and they can go have a wonderful life. I mean, that's not the answer.
Yeah.
There aren't a lot of good answers to reality. Reality has a certain kind of harshness to it. You know, we live on a planet with animals that want to, you know, eat. Yeah, like you go wander around in the desert, something will kill you. Yeah, it's not a safe world. And just because we can talk about how, you know, oh, it's easier to live. We're talking about within the bounds of society, assuming that you are able to obey most of the rules and you don't get into a severe amount of trouble and you're not trying to steal everyone's stuff and murder everyone's children. Yeah, you can make your life hard and bad things can happen. And then if you're lucky, people are going to care about you. And if you're lucky, you're going to be in society that can look at you and have some recognition that you're one of us. Just bad things happened. Like, you had an unfortunate life and you don't get stuck in a society that looks at you and thinks you're a horrible person. Like, you know, I can't relate to you at all. It's too dangerous to even be seen with you. You're that reprehensible. Hopefully that never happens, but we can't control whether or not that happens to people. I'm thinking about what you say about, you know, places around the world, and I'm again thinking about The Wizard of Oz. In the movie, you know, the flying monkeys and the Wicked Witch and all that stuff is portrayed as being this, like, really terrible, evil thing. In the book version, the Wicked Witch isn't that powerful. Like, she's afraid. Like, she doesn't have unlimited magic. She really just has, like, one more magic spell that she can cast, and she winds up using it in order to capture Dorothy. But then she's kind of out of magic, and she's desperate to get Dorothy's slippers, because that's the magic thing that she will give her more power. And right now, like, she has, like, almost nothing. And so people are just around her in fear, because she's keeping them afraid and constantly telling them, hey, I'll cast some spells on you. But she can't. And if they just stood up against her, they would win easily. And I think that the problems that people have aren't that hard. It's just, it takes that little bit of effort. You know, I'm thinking about, you know, this notion of everyone has to do their part. Yeah, but you're on a planet with, let's say, 9 billion people. So your part is just 1/9 billionth of the problem. Solve 1/9 billionth of the problem and you've done your part.
Yeah.
And if everyone does that, we'd be great. And heck, if half the people did that, we'd be great. You don't have to do that much. Just do more than nothing.
Yeah.
And maybe accept that the rest of the world isn't that bad off. You know, people are living. They wake up every day. They go to work. Yeah, maybe it looks strange to you, but maybe it's just the news keeping you afraid. Maybe it's the news telling you all those places are filled with wicked witches. All those places are dangerous and horrible. Therefore, you should pay your taxes and you should love the police and you should accept the way things are, because we could make them so much worse for you. And it's just fear.
Hold on. You said monkeys. She doesn't have that much power. Fear. The problem is I, like, really strongly believe in a person's ability to, like, interact with their free will if they have a better relationship with it. And I think that comes from knowing what you're capable of. So I think a lot of the time people feel like, I have no choice. I have to do what I'm doing. This is the script I was given. But I feel like that's why you have to be introspective, to ask yourself, what are you actually capable of versus what has the world told you you're capable of? Which is why we love a good story about people with no legs who become, like, swimming coaches. We're like, yes, look amazing. Because you really can do some, you can do things. It's kind of amazing what humans can do. We're kind of capable of so much. And then at the same time, we're only able to do what we can do. And I think that's what's so frustrating. Did you hear the story? God, I heard this on Flagrant, Andrew Schultz's podcast. I didn't look it up. So, like, okay. But he said there was a news story recently that came out where a bunch of guys gangbanged a lizard. And I was just sitting there like, you gangbanged a lizard? And then I'm like, why? Like, why a lizard? Like, what's the point? And then I was thinking about it because, like, obviously I hear stories all the time, like Ryan Reynolds and Beverly, Blake Lively have this, like, organization to help kids from getting sex trafficked. And they have gone after pediatricians, OBGYNs, like people who are giving birth and, like, touch the kids while they still have umbilical cords attached. And I'm just sitting here. And so when people look at me and they go, Brittany, all people are valuable. I'm like, I don't know, bro. If you gangbang a lizard, like, I kind of feel like that's evolution should take you out. Like, that you're not going to, people shouldn't want to procreate with people that fuck lizards. Therefore, that person's genetics will die off. Right? And then, like, there's that kind of, like, where a part of me thinks the bad things that are happening to people in the world are sort of a part of the evolutionary process of, like, bye-bye. Like, bye-bye. Because we are just, like, an evolved species. So we have to acknowledge that our ability to interact with the consciousness coincides with our ability to acknowledge our biology and our evolution. And that we might have advantages or disadvantages based off of, like, where we are in that, like, that moment. And so I guess when I look at people and I think about, like, what are people capable of? I mean, you're capable of fucking a lizard. So lots. Like, lots. Plenty. Plenty. Like, you're capable of sitting on this computer for 15 hours a day playing video games. You're capable of lots of things. Even with something, you know, it's just a matter of, like, what are you going to do with it? And so in some ways, my sympathy and empathy goes down for people because I'm like, well, we all have, like, anyone could be a streamer. You all have OBS, don't you? Like, unless you don't, but then you have a different advantage or disadvantage in the world. So if people aren't going to do things, right? Like, being a YouTuber is hard. It took me literally like 10 years to make any money doing it, really. But I kept doing it when everyone was telling me to quit. I just kept doing it. And now I make, you know, pretty good money. But I don't even make it doing YouTube, do I? I do it doing calls. I give a part of myself to people in exchange for their money. And it might be hard, but for me, it's quite easy. And so therefore, it was the thing that I was meant to do. The hard thing that nobody wanted to do was the easy thing for me to do. It just took me 10 years to figure it out. And a lot of people telling me to quit. So I guess when I like look at the horrible stories in the world, like we build these amazing prisons and we convince people to let us like take people who grow a plant and imprison them. Either you are the, like we convinced, like in some ways we're capable of all things. We are the wizard. We're the wizard to ourselves. We convince ourselves of what we're capable of and then we just stop ourselves. Like we're only capable of this much. We've tricked ourselves in so many ways. And it's, I can't even fault humanity for falling for the trick because I did too. Right? I totally fell for the tricks in the beginning, but the tricks aren't even malicious. They're the wizard giving you what you've wanted, which is the placebo. So I can't even be mad. Like, that's the problem, is that that's why I get down to not telling people what to do with their lives, because it, the doctor tells you to work out, you're still not going to do it. The doctor tells you not to get fat so you don't get diabetes, you're still going to do it. It doesn't matter. Instead, I think I take a much more radical, like, fine, be fat, die of diabetes, I don't care. Be skinny, die of diabetes, I don't care. Like, do what you're going to do. Because you're going to do it anyways. And so therefore, the world is exactly the way it should be because it's exactly the way we want it to be. So then I have to go about living my life selfishly and individually because everyone else is anyways. Even while they're advocating for society to do something better, they're still not involved, they're still not voting, they're still not doing it. So what does it matter? I think that was a tangent away from our main conversation. But well, maybe that's why I lack fear as I get older, though. I lack fear because I know that that's how it is, so then it allows me to move forward anyways. What good is fear? Hold on. One last thought and then I'm going to hand it over to you. I had this thought last night while I was in bed. I was really afraid of I get afraid of the dark sometimes. I start to panic that I'm in the dark. And I start to think someone's going to be in my room. Maybe it's my PTSD. I don't know what it is. But I start to panic sometimes. And I go, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And I go, Brittany, stop. Because if you know, Brittany, if somebody was in this room with you, you would be so confident. It's true. When shit hits the fan, when people are afraid, I become so brave. Because it becomes protecting somebody else. But when it's just me alone, I get this like crippling sense of fear sometimes that I can't do anything if it's just about me. But the moment I thought about my partner in bed with me, I was like, oh, I would get up to protect him, which is, you know, like he would do the same. But that was my thought. Think about it. If your brother was in this room, you wouldn't even care if there was a noise in your closet. You'd get up and be like, what is it? But the fact that I'm alone, the fear stops me. Like I start to hyperventilate even in my own room. How insane is that? But the moment I think about someone else and needing to protect them, I become so brave. So maybe it's that, like I can face the fear because I have a damn good reason to. If you don't have a good enough reason to, maybe it's better to be afraid.
That and what I was hearing was also just the plain psychology of it. We are animals who enjoy like that sort of tribal life or maybe not enjoy, but it gives us a strength. Like when we're in a pack, we feel stronger. Like, you know, you see a mob, they fucking feel like they can do anything. They go crazy. They go wild. The rules stop applying to them. It can go too far in that direction. But definitely when you get down to just the individual, and if you tell someone, you're all alone, you're helpless, no one loves you, no one's going to help you, yeah, your family's against you, society wants to kill you. Yeah, if you make people feel afraid and helpless, then they don't feel capable. Like they just want to cower. They'll do whatever they're told. You know, you want my money here, fine, take it. You want whatever, take it. They won't stand up for themselves or other people if they're alone or they feel alone at the time that they're doing it. But yeah, you get people in a group and suddenly you got protesters. And they can be happy about it. Like, you know, you can get people who are out there waving their signs, feeling good. It doesn't all have to be like this, you know, riots in the night and, you know, burning things down and stuff like that. There are plenty of protests where the people are just like baking brownies and feeling good about what they're doing because they see that their neighbors want to do the same thing.
Yeah.
And they realize I'm in a community of people who are normal and want good things. And that's part of what I see when I see all these people, though. I see that these people, even though they're afraid, they have good motivations. Like, they're there terrified that bad things are going to happen. They're not trying to make bad things happen.
Right.
They're just afraid. And so because I can see that they're afraid and they wish for the world to be better, I'm not afraid of them. Like, I know that they're being told that the answers are things like, oh, well, we have to ban marijuana and we have to ban sex and we have to you know, live some traditional lifestyle that never really existed anyway. You know, they're being told a bunch of nonsense and maybe they're believing it. And if it goes too far, then yes, it can have bad outcomes like prohibition and you know, banning, you know, just all the things that can happen that we know aren't good. But at the same time, I know that things aren't going to go too terribly far because they're not evil people. You know, they're not really setting out to do harm. And if they see that they are doing harm, they regret it and they change their minds. It might take them 50 years, but they figure it out eventually. And I think that the one thing that I want for people is to have them just avoid, to distrust anyone who's trying to make them afraid. Because going back to the story, the Wicked Witch rules her kingdom by making people afraid. She's not really that powerful, but she terrorizes people and makes them think that she's going to do bad things to them, and so they all obey her. And meanwhile, she herself lives this very pained life where she's afraid as well. And she's not confident and strong, and she's constantly living a bad, upsetting, horrible life, and, mm-hmm. and she has reasons why she has to use fear to control people. The Wizard of Oz, like I said, he's lying to everyone too. He has this fake mm-hmm. Emerald City, but he's not making people afraid of anything. He's using, you know, the normal lies of government. He's not able to tell people the truth because they can't handle the truth or they don't want to hear it. He's an enlightened tyrant in many ways, but that's what people need sometimes. You know, people can't do everything. They need someone to just sort of take some things off their back. So I understand that a little bit. That you can't just have a completely chaotic, you know, society where everyone goes and lives on their own. If you want to have a civilization, you have to trust other people somewhat, and they're going to lie to you sometimes, but it's for your own good. Like there's a complexity there to be observed, but it's not about fear. He's not telling them you have to stay in the Emerald City because otherwise the Wicked Witch is going to come kill you. He really cares about people, and he's doing his best. And they're the ones who push all this deception on him, really. I look at all these people in the world, and I don't really worry that much. I have a higher opinion somewhat. Like, I do think that if they were given a little bit more perspective on how much people are making them afraid, then it would make them better people. I have said this before. I think that the internet is doing that. I think YouTube is doing that. I think that they're able now to look around the world and see that all these people in other countries are making TikTok videos and are being goofy and have the same sense of humor that they do and like the same memes they do. And everyone speaks different languages, but no one cares anymore. You can just translate back and forth and understand everything. And we are so rapidly getting away from that old fear-based, you know, they're a slightly different color than me, therefore they're completely different and they're going to try to kill me in my sleep, to a culture of, oh, they're a different color than me, I bet they have good food and a neat dance that I don't know, and maybe they make good video games. Like, we are getting slowly to a world where there's openness and appreciation, but we're pulling so much fear with us that we don't need.
Well, also because of the internet, yesterday I retweeted, God, I saw the funniest video about the insurrection or January 6th, and it was so funny. Like, it was literally done like a movie trailer, like, duk, 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 duk. Trump tells his viewers to go to the, and I'm just like, bro, like, why are you doing this? Why are you sensationalizing this so much? And, like, I don't know why people were so afraid of January 6th, but don't understand, like, that's just a, like, I looked at it, I was like, cool, a protest. Do you think it happens any different when you guys burn down, like, police cars? Or break into businesses? Like, it's the same. The way that the left makes the right, like, they're like, just a reminder, if Trump comes back to Twitter, this is what Trump, like, inspires in people. Yeah. So the clip you guys showed, and you're like, I'm so afraid of these, like, conservatives. The conservatives see you guys, like, burning down police cars and think the same fucking shit. I see you both, and I'm like, great, you're a bunch of adults in middle age or plus blowing up your own fucking buildings you use to pay for it, your tax dollars. You're burning money. Your money. And that's all I see is like you're burning your own money. And I'm like, great. Perfect. I love that. Let's burn down our own stuff. Because like that's how our brains are as humans. Like we literally destroy things because we're afraid. So we just like burn it to the ground. I'm like, was that the solution? But that's the thing is that I remember being in it. I remember protesting with the Tea Parties. I remember protesting with the like the BLM people. It made me feel like I was there and it meant something and it was powerful and important. But the truth is like that was how many years ago? And I'm just like ended up in my room like being a somewhat basically bad streamer. Like that's what I ended up doing with my time. And you know what's funny is like another BLM protester is the one who got me out of it because she was like, what are we accomplishing? And I was like, I don't know. And this was not a white woman. Like, you know what I mean? We sat there and we're like, what are we accomplishing? We weren't, because we knew people were stealing money. We knew the behind the closed doors people were lying. We knew they were using fear as a tactic to move people in a direction. And it wasn't about love or community or, you know, creating harmony. And so you end up looking at the world and thinking, you know what? I don't need this particular placebo of feeling good, like I'm doing something when I'm not. But I appreciate that other people can utilize this placebo. I'm not upset when people are protesters. I think it's very inefficient, but I also understand that in some ways it does move people forward because of those protests. And I do think they have a moment, like a help. Like I learned different things about myself and can communicate that to my family. I mean, without protesters, I don't think we'd have what we have, but I still don't think it is always like great or efficient in the way that we do it. I think January 6th was like a great example of inefficiency. Like, what did we accomplish? What was the point of that? Why was nobody I knew at those protests? Who showed up? What kind of a person does it take to like storm, you know what I mean, a government building the way they did? Like, you and I weren't there. None of my family members were there. Like, there's no way you could have convinced my family that this was efficient because it wasn't. So why did they do it? It's not that they're evil racists. Like, it must be something more than that. Is it just the simplicity, like the fact that they were just there? And then like once the crowd started moving, people were like, yeah, let's move. Like, were they just stealing podiums because they thought that was really going to help civil liberties? Or were they just like memeing? You know what I mean? So I'm much more lenient on people in mobs in some ways because I'm like, look how stupid they all are together, like a school of fish. And then in some ways, I'm afraid of them because God forbid they turn their attention on me. I'm fucking dead. So like I live in this constant world where I'm afraid of the mob. And then I'm also like pitying them because they like think they're doing something good, but you're just like blowing up people for no reason. Like, why are you doing this? You're doing it because you're afraid and you think that your fear is a good motivator and a justified reason to cause more harm. And I can't even be mad because that's so human. Like, that's so basic, right? Like, I just think about the way that I was raised in my allegedly perfect family. And I think about all the times that I was like, my parents like came and like shattered all my CDs in front of me to break every single one to prove to me that like, this is what you do when you break the rules and you try to find music with cuss words on it. My parents were so afraid of word sounds that they broke all these CDs that I had like secretly bought. Or my mom would snoop through my drawers to find all the rated R movies I was watching or PG-13 shows I was seeing. And out of fear, they did this. But what did it end up doing? Years later, my parents were like, oh, that was kind of silly. I was like, oh, yeah, no shit. But like perfectly sane adults made this decision because at the time they thought it was right. But it's just kind of silly. And it's kind of embarrassing. But it also is what humans do. Like humans are going to human. We're going to go through these cycles of doing embarrassing shit. Like I was thinking about it this morning while brushing my teeth. I was like, man, I can't wait for like 50 years to go by. And everyone's going to look at us like, man, look at those idiots and what they did then. And I'm trying to always think, what am I doing right now that in the future we're going to look back and think, well, that was stupid. But people don't think that. People think like we're in the most modern time. So we're making all the best modern decisions. And I think that's the funny part about it. Oh, and why is Trump so stupid, but y'all are so afraid of him? I don't get that either. Like, is Trump an idiot or not? And if that's true, then why are we letting him, like, stay in control? Because we believe in the system and we believe in the way that it's gone. I didn't see those libs going and actually, like, protesting and, like, actually doing something to get him out. There are, like, millions of them, right? Couldn't they have gone and just physically removed him? But they're not going to because they're going to follow the rules of the society because they do believe in it and they do know it's good and it's good enough.
Yeah, most of them. And I think that's so one of the things that we were going to talk about was that difference between the high trust and the low trust people.
Yeah.
And part of what you're talking about, it gets right to that. It's this notion of whether or not you're, like, if you have a protest that's all about making people afraid, then that's always going to be counterproductive. Because if you make people afraid, they're going to act against you. They're not going to listen to you. They're not going to be sympathetic. They're kind of not going to move towards your views. people always have this, or yeah, not always, but people often have this idea of, well, I just need to scare people into giving me what I want. And if they give me what I want, then I won't shoot them or whatever it is. And no, that's not how it works. And if it does work that way in the short term, where you're pointing that gun at them and they give you, you know, the money in the cash register, they will later find you and put you in prison. Because you know, they have an entire society on their side and they have all the time in the world, and you can't get away with things forever. And if you operate by making people afraid, people will deal with that because people don't want to be afraid.
Mm.
Like that's why if you have, you know, riots on the street and they're going to burn things down, then you risk having you know, the military called in, or you know, the police empowered to just round everyone up and impose martial law. And if you have people who storm the government and, you know, they do something that looks like an insurrection or could be called an insurrection, and no matter how goofy these actual people are, and how no matter how legitimately harmless they would have been, no matter what they did, you know, because they were just memeing and stealing podiums and half of them were lost. Like, who knows what they were doing? You know, like, I'm sure that they did not actually have a plan to form a government.
I don't think
none over America.
None of them are smart enough to even think past getting there. There's no way none of them. No one had a plan, obviously.
Yeah, but they make people afraid, and so they make people sufficiently afraid that Congress, you know, the entire government of the United States, will for the next couple years put them in prison and tell them you did bad, and like, you know, that they made people sufficiently afraid that society is going to tell them don't do this again. And society is right, by the way. Like, as much as I'm sympathetic to them just being stupid, society's right. You can't be that stupid.
Right.
This is America. We're the superpower. We have nuclear weapons. We have all sorts of important things going on. We can't have random schmucks wandering into certain government buildings.
Right.
We just can't do that. And it doesn't matter how innocent or foolish you are in the wrong place at the wrong time. Sorry.
Yeah.
Don't do it.
Which sucks, because you know I hate prisons, and I'm just like, whoa! Like, I listened to that one guy who got the horn guy, the guy with the horns, the famous one. I listened to an interview he had, and I was so sympathetic towards him. And I'm like, why would you do this? Why would you destroy your whole life for a protest? But then you're told, growing up, you know, sacrifice your life. Would you, remember the Columbine shooters? Do you remember how they would ask, like, allegedly, like, do you believe in Jesus Christ? And then if you said yes, you were shot. My mom raised us saying, like, are you going to die for Jesus Christ? And then when I was a kid, I was like, yes. When I got older, I was like, man, I'm going to lie out my ass. Like, there ain't no way I'm dying for, like, nothing. And so I sat there and I thought about this man. He's sitting in prison now. He's been used as, like, the example of, like, the most horrible person on January 6th. But I'm just looking at him like, man, you're dumb. And dumb people, I do feel bad for. But then you're right. We have a society. We have responsibilities. We cannot allow your paranoia to allow you to hurt anything we've established. Like, we can't allow it, but it also sucks. Because I don't want to throw these people in prison. Like, can you imagine? I hate punishing stupid people. I feel very bad about it. And I think that's the problem, is, like, I feel emotionally very bad about it, but then my solution is, like, no jail, but you have to do something, like, anything, but, I understand how modern-day slavery works, so then I'm, like, you can work for free, but then that's, like, slavery-based, and I don't want that. So there's no good solution, except maybe don't be so stupid enough to, like, protest in the first place inefficiently. Like, maybe that's it, but I don't feel bad for Kyle Rittenhouse either. Like, I don't feel bad for him. And how his life went. Because I'm like, yeah, you were dumb. You took a gun to a protest and you killed someone. Like, you fucking idiot. So then I'm, like, upset with him for throwing away his whole life over something that wasn't even that important. You know what I mean? But then I feel bad for everybody in that regard. Where I'm like, stop throwing your life away for, like, systems. Systems suck. They're not worth it.
Yeah. I mean, acting from fear and acting in mobs and acting without thinking is usually a really bad idea. And it's unfortunate that we can't save people from these things. It's unfortunate that we can't just go to all the people who were unjustly put into a prison and say, you know, I'm just going to wave a magic wand and let you out. But, you know, there are structural reasons why, you know, we're trying to have a society and we have certain rules that we're trying to follow. One could just as easily look at the people and say, hey, why did you do those drugs? Why did you deal those drugs? Or why did you steal that stereo? Like, whatever it is they did, like, they didn't have to do that either. So I feel very sympathetic for them, but at the same time, they did something. Now, I agree with you, prison is terrible, the way that it's all, like, it's a complicated subject. It's horrible. And just because it's horrible doesn't mean that we shouldn't address it, but I think I'm sort of saying it's too big a topic for us to get into suddenly.
Yeah.
But I would say that the one thing that I think about is with regard to like high trust and low trust is that high trust model is one where you believe that the other person isn't that bad.
Mm-hmm.
And you think, okay, you know, maybe Trump gets elected and he runs things for a while. Then maybe Biden gets elected and he runs things for a while. You don't go into it thinking, if the person I don't like gets elected, then they're going to round us all up. They're going to kill us all. We're never going to be allowed to vote again. Like, our lives are over. Like, our backs are up against the wall, and we have to fight as if we were about to die. Because that's not true. I mean, Trump is there because, you know, roughly half the country wants him there. Roughly half the country. That's a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
They can't all be crazy.
Mm-hmm.
It can't, like, on both sides, it can't be that all of these people are crazy, and it can't be that they're going to do horrible things to the other half.
Mm-hmm.
You just have to look at it and, like, or at least you don't have to, but what I would say is look at it and think, they're just like you, and they're going to be sympathetic to you. You don't think they are, but they will be. When they get into power, they will maybe move things in their direction, but they're going to remember that you're human beings. They're going to remember that you have your own desires and you want to be like gay or whatever. You know, they're not going to say, okay, it's time to open the death camps.
Right.
People don't do that. People generally just want everyone to leave them alone and get along. And if they push things in their direction a little bit, it's just them saying, please don't hurt me at the end of the day.
Yeah.
It's them saying, I'm afraid of you. You're different than me. Please don't hurt me. And the best thing everyone can do to preserve their rights and preserve their freedoms is not scare people.
I think the problem is that for so long, especially growing up as like a gay kid, a lot of us feel like our literal existence, like just existing, puts fear in people. So no matter what we'll do, they'll be afraid of us. And that is kind of true. It is true that prior to my parents having three gay or queer kids, my parents were afraid of gay people in like a real way. Like, afraid of them. They weren't, like, they were literally the definition of homophobic. Like, they were, like, disgusted and afraid because they thought, like, gay people were pedophiles. Because the only gay person they knew in Iraq was a pedophile. So they're like, then all gay people must be pedophiles. So I was like, okay, I see how you got there. And, like, it was really hard as a kid to internalize that, right? Like, I had to internalize that for a lot of my life where I was like, oh, my God, am I a pedophile at, like, 8 years old? It was very confusing, though, because I'm a kid. So if I had sex with another kid, am I just, like, am I a pedophile? Or am I just, it was a lot, like a lot for an 8-year-old brain to kind of process. But that is something that I had to learn to process because of my environment. So my therapist kept trying to explain to me how my parents accidentally gave me borderline. And I was like, okay, explain this to me. And she said, well, what happened was like your whole life you heard this thing about gays and pedophiles, internalized it as a child and pre-abandoned yourself because you knew that in your head they were going to kill you or they were going to kick you out of the house because like who wants to harbor a pedophile, right? Who in any society harbors a pedophile technically, right? So then you like internalize this and you abandon yourself and then you felt like your parents abandoned you. So your whole life you were trying to find an identity outside of gayness, but because you still had all this attraction to women, you just didn't know how to separate it. And you're like, well, that's who I am. I'm a person who likes women and therefore I must be a predator of some kind. And then you did this and you looped your whole life until finally one day you start to read books about other gay people and then other gay people start to come out and then you start to realize like, oh wait, maybe gay people aren't this way. Maybe it was a misunderstanding of even my parents who are these older, wiser people of me who should know better. Maybe they don't know better. And once as a child adult, I could process that maybe adults don't know better. It allowed me to forgive myself and give myself space to be something that I didn't know I could be, which was just a normal person who happened to like girls. And then after I got therapy and she taught me that you need to learn how other people are thinking. They're not even thinking about hurting you. They're thinking about protecting you or the people around them. Think about it. Your parents might think, ooh, a gay person is a pedophile. Well, who are we supposed to protect more than children? right? So at the sacrifice of the gay person, for the safety of the child, better for the gay person to be killed. Or just ostracized from society and kicked out. Because again, we're protecting children. So out of fear and love, your parents gave you this like mental loop now that you have to suffer with for the like remainder of your adult life. But this is what I mean when I say like the road to hell is paved in good intentions. How can I hate my parents for having this thought when I see this thought come from everyone in my life? How could people vote for Trump, Brittany? Do you think they're all awful racist KKK people? Well, that seems like a huge like leap, but not really, because in their heads, everyone they see who vote for Trump also vote for these tiki torch people in khaki pants. So of course they come to the conclusion in their own brain. And of course the fear makes them go, oh my God, okay, good. If they're gay, they're pedophiles. If they're Trump voters, they're white nationalists. I got it. I'm allowed to be afraid of these people because these people are bad. But that's not how the world works. That's not how people work. Of course you're going to find gay people that aren't pedophiles and are. And then you're going to find people who voted for Trump who are white nationalists and who are not white nationalists. So again, I think that fear is like this thing that can protect you, but it can also make you a horrible person. Because now you become the torturer of innocent people because of your fear, and now the loop continues. So again, we can be angry at people who are torturing us, or we can try to find out how they got there in the first place. And if fear is the answer, then how are we allowing our fear to then cause other people trauma and like pain?
Yeah, and it doesn't even have to be equal. Like if you make people a little bit afraid, it justifies all their fears. Like you just have to be a little bit aggressive, and it's enough for them to think you're everything. You're justifying everything that I don't like about that group of people. And that, I mean, obviously that's stupid, but their fears were stupid to begin with. But it's just the way people are. People are very susceptible to fear. It's very difficult to overcome. And you have to really go through the looking glass a little bit. Like with the gay people, you have to look at conversion therapy and say how loving that is. They didn't kill me. They wanted to cure me. They wanted to fix me. They love me. Like obviously the actual reality is horrible. Mm-hmm. But from the perspective of the person who thinks that they can like help this person who's suffering from gayness, they're filled with at least clearly good intentions. Relative to let's round them up and kill them. You just have to have a certain ability to see from the other person's point of view what's in their heart, like what that they're decent, good people doing their best. And ultimately, like I never want to say that it's our responsibility to educate other people, because that's not possible. Like it's like it's not our responsibility to go shove therapy down other people's throats. People have to want therapy. People have to want to educate themselves. People have to want to learn. They have to be open-minded, not afraid. And it has to be that they have ways of learning. Like the one thing we can provide is give people ways of learning that don't threaten them, that don't intimidate them, that don't make them seem like they're a bad person for being curious. And frankly, you know, there's not a lot of that.
No.
You know, there's books. Yeah, you can read a book by yourself quietly and no one knows, and maybe it'll expand your horizons. Even once you get into like YouTube though and social media, like it's too tempting to suddenly be part of a community and to respond in the comments, and next thing you know, you're engaged with people and you're not just educating yourself, but you're fighting for something, and people are going to fight back, and then you're not going to learn. And it's very, very difficult to find ways to really lower your own levels of fear and accept that the other people, in their hearts at least, aren't that bad. Even though in reality they might be rounding you up, but in their hearts they're trying to do good, and maybe the answer is that we shouldn't have gotten to this point in the first place. We shouldn't have made them this afraid.
I'm trying to think about the low trust, high trust thing, because like I put myself in a lot of situations where I think some people might say like, oh, that's not reasonable. Like you shouldn't have put yourself in that situation. And sometimes I think my high trust allows me to take the risk that somebody might turn out to be great. And so I do it because I am hoping that they're like me, where they're genuinely just kind of different, but they mean the best. And then sometimes people, even when they mean the best, do cause the worst, right? So I think that being open to both of those possibilities allows us to have an ability to move forward or make peace with every situation that happens, bad or good. Like, I don't think I have to turn on someone just because we disagree, but I do become afraid. Even I become afraid when people start saying things like, we should just, like, you know, take all sex workers, like, and just not legalize this, not humanize sex workers. Because in my head, I'm like, why are you trying to cockblock me so hard, bro? Like, why are you trying to cockblock my joy, my happiness? I'm telling you right now, I'm happy. But my own voice isn't enough to convince a person. They have to feel it themselves. So then I start to think, fine, I'll bring you around sex workers. But if I brought them around every unethical sex worker, they would also think sex work was bad. Hell, I would think sex work was bad. So the dilemma is that we pick and choose what we're allowed to experience. Like, we'll have a woman who has one bad experience with a man and she's allowed to be sexist and misandrist and allowed to be like, men suck. But the moment you have one bad experience with a Middle Eastern person, well, no, you can't say they're bad because they're Middle Eastern. That's like racism, right? But is it? Like, at the end of the day, if we're allowing your bad experiences to dictate how you feel, then everyone should have that, right? But we don't allow that to happen. Right. So we don't even. So instead, let's just not even give in to the fear. But let's talk about how we experience it, even when we don't want to. Like, I have PTSD. So sometimes I have like irrational thoughts of fear, but I have to coach myself through it. I have to tell myself, you're not allowed to be afraid right now. You have no evidence to be afraid. Being in the room with a man is not evidence to be afraid. But then someone could say, but Brittany, look at the statistics. And I could say, fuck your statistics. Look at your life. How many men have hit you today? How many of us even have? I've never been hit by a man. Well, wait, that's not true. That's not true. Wait, I have been hit by a man. But is there a loophole for this man because of the circumstance? I think technically there's a loophole for it. And it's not BDSM. That's interesting. Wait. You know what situation I'm talking about, right?
I was thinking of BDSM immediately, and now I'm not thinking of it.
No, it's not BDSM. I wonder if there's a loophole. But see, I don't want to talk about it because the mob's going to hear it and they're not going to understand it because they're stupid. And because they're afraid, they're going to think horrible things versus like taking the nuance of the conversation. See, I don't think the internet deserves this story because they're too fucking stupid. And they're too fucking afraid. Fuck. Okay, I have been hit by a man. But I will allow the context of the situation to occur because I think it was within a rational response, though irrational at the same time. So, damn, I can't share this story. See, and I know I can hear the feminist voices being like, oh, she's probably justifying blah, 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 blah. But no, you're wrong. Fuck you. Damn, my life does allow more nuance, I think, than the average person.
But also, it doesn't matter whether or not you individually were hit by a man. You're intelligent enough to see that men exist and they could hit you. Like,
that's true.
I've never been eaten by a lion, but I know that it could happen. I don't need it to happen in order to.
But the point I'm trying to make is that I'm not sure that you need to be afraid of men in general. But see, once I went to therapy, I stopped being paranoid about men and I just started to take men as individuals. And then I decided, individually speaking, I can be afraid of certain men. So, like, I'm afraid of Max, Mr. Girl, because obviously he exhibits behaviors that could put me in harm, and he's willing to admit that he's willing to harm women, so, like, that makes me hesitant, right? But another man, like, I just went to Miami, and I stayed around a bunch of men, and I risked my safety with them, because I gave myself a pros and cons list of, like, well, they're less likely to hurt me, right? So, like, I trusted them, because I have high trust in them, but, you know what, I'm trying to parse out. Like, my life has given me experience to know why I can trust these men, but not these men. But then I was open to the fact, well, maybe I miscalculated. So then I'm willing to, like, be open to the idea that I can miscalculate my trust as well. I don't know.
Well, you just have to be willing to take some risks. So let's go back to Wizard of Oz. Dorothy, much like you, went on a tour. Like, she wandered around. Good things happened. Also, bad things happened. She runs into monsters. She gets attacked at certain times. It happens to be that she has friends around her who help, but she, you know, there are certain situations that she solves on her own. She isn't constantly, she's not unable to go down the yellow brick road because she just is paralyzed, you know, at square one, thinking bad things could exist. No, you gotta accept that bad things could exist, and you go on the adventure.
One of the things that stood out to me is the tin swords, tin woodsman. He says, I've been moaning and groaning for a year and no one's come to see me. And then Dorothy did. And I wondered how many people heard him and thought, oh, scary monster, I can't. And how many people, Dorothy, decided, oh, let's see what it is. Because it could be person who needs help, or it could be something good. She just went for it. She wanted to see what it was. Her curiosity allowed her to save someone versus her fear. My fear would have been like, oh, I hear a noise coming from the forest. I don't know if I want to investigate, right? But maybe the lack of investigation like denies you a chance at friendship or joy or good things or saving someone. And so those are the moments in life where you're like, ooh, is this my moment to help someone? Or is this like my brother? He took me to the airport from Miami and he picked up a hitchhiker. And I was like, you picked up a hitchhiker? He was like, yeah. He's like, I'm glad. Like, I wouldn't tell you to pick up a hitchhiker. You're a woman. But I picked up a hitchhiker. I put him in the front seat and he was crazy. But he was really nice and cool. He was like in his 50s. And he talked about like I offered to buy him food. And he's like, no, man, just buy me booze. He's like, man, I'm not buying you booze. I'll buy you food and water, though. And the guy's like, no, I don't want it. I want alcohol. And he goes, I know you want alcohol, bro. I'm not going to fucking buy it for you. Do you want food or not? And the guy was like, no, I don't want fucking food. And my brother's like, okay, here you go. Here, I'll give you some money. Peace out, bro. Good luck. What is my brother supposed to do in that moment except exactly that? Listen to the man, respect the fact that he's an alcoholic, and respect the fact that my brother's values won't let him buy alcohol. But the man didn't want food. So we have to allow this man to starve because he's decided that that's what he wants, right? Even though it's an addiction reason. And so my brother, working within his confidence and lack of fear, picked up this man and gave him an opportunity, but the man didn't take it. So the man was not afraid of starving. Because he, you know what I mean? The man isn't really afraid of being alone. He told a story, I don't know if it's true, that he had to climb a tree because we have wolves in the area. He had to climb a tree to avoid a pack of wolves. And a ranger found him because he saw the pack of wolves by a tree and he thought that was weird. Saw a man in the tree and picked him up. And I don't know if this is true, but if that's a story, that's amazing that this man continued to risk being homeless and walk the streets to fight wolves rather than taking food from my brother and like maybe a hotel, like whatever my brother would have extended to him. But isn't that interesting? Like, in kind of beautiful in a way. Like, this man is operating on a completely different relationship with fear than the average person.
Yeah. I'm also thinking that he might know. Like, people know things that you don't know that they know.
Yeah.
Like, he might know 100 people willing to give him food. Like, he might know where the soup kitchen is. Food might not be his problem at all.
Good point.
And if he's willing to sleep outside, a hotel might not be of any value to him. Like,
good
he,
point.
He might know where he can go to take a shower when he wants to. Booze might be the one thing that's difficult for him to get because you have to go to the store where they sell it and they will not sell it. They will not, there is no booze kitchen. So
yeah.
Getting alcohol is probably the one thing that's difficult for him and the one thing that you can truly do to help him.
Would you have given him alcohol?
Well, there are a lot of things I wouldn't do.
Okay. Like pick him up in the first place. I can't believe my brother did that. I was like, man. But like, my brother loved that moment. He has a good story now. And now I have a story to tell you. So it is kind of cool that he got to pick. I always dream about picking up hitchhikers, to be honest. But I'm a pussy. And I'm afraid of getting killed. So like, I won't pick them up. But that's the thing. Is like, some moments, fear allows you to miss an opportunity. But it also doesn't matter too much. Like, in that moment, I don't think my fear of picking up a hitchhiker is too bad to operate off of. It's like a pros and cons list. But at the same time, man, I wish I had a cool hitchhiker story. Yeah.
And there is, like, again, in The Wizard of Oz, they do all basically say to Dorothy, we are so lucky that you found us. Because they all were stuck without her. They all could never have solved their problems on their own. And they all basically credit her with solving their problems.
Mm.
Even though, of course, she doesn't. Like, but she does in a way. Like, she is a catalyst on their journey. She is something that does help them get to their solution, even though the solution was inside them all the time. And it is the case that with people, like, it goes to your value system. Like, there's no simple answer to almost all this. For me, there's a certain kind of picking up hitchhikers that I'm not going to do because there are other people in my life that are important to me, and me getting killed by some random hitchhiker would impact other people
mm-hmm.
who I'm focused on doing good things for. And so I'm not going to make that choice. If I was a complete, like, if I was, you know, younger and a loner and all these things, and I was just taking care of myself, or I should say when I was, then I was much more open to interacting with strangers and doing things like that because I was just risking me. And it was a much easier risk for me to accept.
Totally, 100%. I think I'm people's Dorothy in my calls, because I always tell my callers, like, you already know why you're calling me. You already know what's going on. I'm just like the whiteboard or the sounding board to like say it back to you in a way that's different so you can hear what you already know differently. But that's what I think it is. I think that the thing I'm good at least with the callers that I have like that chemistry with, because you do have to have a caller that's open and you do have to have a caller that can hear me without me judging them. Because sometimes I'll say things that I'm like, hey, I know this is going to sound really offensive, but I just need to say it out loud to make sure we've, you know, you've thought about it this way. Have you thought that you're the problem? Like, you know what I mean? And I need people to be open to that without thinking I'm judging them because I don't know them enough. That's like the loophole with the job, is that I don't know you enough to actually judge you. So I'm the best person to give you what I'm seeing because I'm not biased. I don't know you. I don't live your life. Like, I don't know if you're a good person or a bad person. I'm just trying to give you advice, right? Or like do whatever. Be a sounding board. And so I think in those ways, it can be scary from people's perspective of like, Brittany, aren't you afraid people are going to listen to your advice? And what if it doesn't help them? And I'm like, well, I mean, that's like saying like when you ask your mom for advice, is it always going to help? No. But that's the point, is that it could. And then you test it and you're like, nope, didn't work. Life is like science. You have to test it and see what works for you. But there's not a solution one size fits all. And so you have to be brave to take the risk that something you tried didn't work. So you can come back to the drawing board and try something else. And you have to try until it works for you. Because otherwise, like, you can take the other path of stagnation and that's fine too. But then I don't want to hear you complain. Ever.
And you can go too far in the other direction very easily. Where, imagine if people came to you for advice and your advice was always, well, you know what you should do? You should call a professional therapist. It's like there's a point where you're just passing the buck. Where you're not doing anything for anyone.
Right.
Like if Dorothy comes across the Tin Woodsman and basically says, well, next time I see someone who's a mechanic, I'll let him know that you're out here. Have a good day, sir.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a point where you have to try something.
Yes.
At least if you're, and you have to respect that other people are going to be able to hear your advice or hear your comments or hear your questions, whatever it is, and process it. And if you come across to them as being, you know, useless, fine. Like, that's their judgment to make. They're empowered. It's their life. They don't have to do what you say. They're a person. You show respect for another person when you let them make their own choices.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, that's what it is, too. It's like that tiny contradiction you're living in life. It's like, I trust you enough to make your choices, but it's the wrong one. And then the other side of it is that I'm afraid for you because I know it's the wrong one. Or maybe it's not the wrong one and you don't know. But the fear really comes from a place of like wanting to protect, which again goes down to everything we're ever doing. When we limit other people's agency, we usually are doing it with good intentions, which I give great weight to. I personally do give great weight, I think even more than you do, to good intentions, from anything from like pranking someone where you accidentally prank someone, they're old, they get a heart attack and die. It's like, okay, like that was, you know. And then at the same time, like, we want to think about how to be better community members because we've done these things and fucked up and we can learn from them. So I think like fear has a place. It's maybe fear in a healthy way is more like consideration. Like, I want to be considerate to the old person and maybe not do a prank on them in case they might die. So I'm afraid because I'm considerate. But then that can land. Maybe. And then it can be toxic, I think, in the wrong, like if it's amplified too far.
Yeah. I mean, part of why I don't like the pranks is because they increase the amount of fear.
Ah, but they also increase the amount of joy in my bubbles. Like, I feel like I love a good prank. I love a fun prank, a wholesome prank. Like, you know, like you used to watch those shows as kids and like it was so fun, or like we do pranks even to each other. And like if it's wholesome and fun, it's just funny. Even if you accidentally break an arm, like as long as it's like wholesome and fun, it's funny. But also I come from a family that I just said this in VC. Wait, what was the example I used? Oh, scammer. I had a friend who was scammed on Craigslist for a rental and they didn't go see the rental or anything, but they paid the money and did it. And then on the move-in day, the guy just ghosted them and took their money. And for my friend, I had to be very sympathetic. I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe that happened. That's so awful. Because I knew my friend was really sensitive to this because she lives in a world where like, how could people be this cruel? And I'm like, oh yeah. But like, if it was my siblings, I'd be like, you fucking idiot. Like I would laugh because my siblings know better. So I hold them to a higher standard of knowing better. So if they get scammed, it's on them. Because like they know better. But my friend, in some ways, I have to treat her with kid gloves because she lives in a reality where like, I can't, even her own mom was like, I can't believe people like this exist. I was like, well, you're a Bill Clinton fan. You can't, you don't think people lie? Like, this is like it. Like, you, they don't believe people lie. Which is like such a funny idea, right? Because all they talk about is how Trump is a liar and Trump's a bad person. That's what the scammer was on Craigslist. He was a liar. And then you sit there and turn around and I'm like, I can't believe people do this. And I'm like, what do you mean? What do you mean you can't believe people do this? You can't believe people are going to human?
Yeah, I completely agree with that. It reminds me of that when we're talking about this, you said something before that reminded me of this as well. Jordan Peterson puts forward that idea that, like, when you make that kind of mistake, a trust mistake, like cheating was the other example, it calls into question not just was this decision a bad decision, but am I capable of making good decisions? Mm. Like, I was fooled here. Maybe I'm being fooled by everyone. Like, yeah, maybe I can never trust anyone again in my whole life. Maybe I, you know, like, everything terrible is going to happen. And yeah, you do have to be able to, like, tune your brain to get to a point where you can be tricked and you can be fooled and you can buy into some propaganda. You can believe the advertisement and it turns out that the product doesn't do what it said it was going to do. And you realize, ha ha, you know, yes, it's wrong. Yes, mm-hmm. It's fraud. Yes, maybe even if it's a really bad thing, I'll call the police or I'll do whatever is necessary to deal with the actual real world consequences. But I don't have to completely doubt myself. I don't have to lose faith in humanity and think Everyone is a liar. And I don't have to think that I'm going to fall for every lie. I just got tricked once because it happens. And that's one of the things about living in a high trust society is you're vulnerable to being tricked. And it's just part of what you have to deal with. Mm-hmm. It's one of the small costs is that every now and then someone's going to take advantage of you, but you will, in theory, overall have such a relatively better life that you'll be able to absorb it. And, you know, if you were tricked in a way where someone takes all of your money and now your children are starving, okay, that was a bad thing. You probably have some responsibility for that. And maybe in that case, you are the kind of person who shouldn't be allowed to make your own judgments. Yeah, and you need to really start questioning whether or not you can take care of your kids. Mm. There's a point where it does become real.
Yeah.
But there's also a point where it's not a big deal. You know, with pranks, if you play a prank on someone and you've taken consideration to make sure that it's going to be relatively harmless for them, great. But if you play a prank on someone and you like scare them in the dark and you make them think that you're going to rob them and they pull out a gun and shoot you, and they have to go to jail because of your prank, not good.
Yeah, like, yeah, yeah. You
know, that's not a good prank. And you know, there are lines out there, and it's not as simple as always and never. But you got to find the lines, and that is difficult, I admit.
That was a real prank. That was a news story. Do you remember that news story about the three brothers? And one of them went outside to play the prank on his brothers, and the brother grabbed a gun and shot him. That was a real prank. That was a real story that I'm like, bro. And like, so even my brothers are like, okay, you don't fuck with people who own guns. Like, that's the one thing you don't do. Actually, my brothers and I, we have an understanding that you never try to sneak onto our houses, never try to prank us with like a burglary. We have an open, because we know this happens. So we talk about it. So that's the other thing people don't do is my family does this thing where like we watch someone do something like great, noted, hey, let's not do that. But other people do not learn from other people's mistakes the way my family does. Like, we're like, oh, noted. Like, it's really important. But hold on. You said something. Low trust society. People. Oh, somebody wrote in my comments about the when I talked to ABBA. And he goes, Brittany just doesn't understand. When you've been betrayed enough, like, it's hard to make friends. Girl, I got more betrayal stories than Hamlet. Like, I got story after story after story. And all of them, you know, even the worst three, like, I think about the worst ones. Like, I think the worst ones I felt were the ones where women accused me of, like, sexually violating them. Those were the worst ones because they came from women that I trusted, women that I thought I could trust intimately with my body and mind and soul, women that I thought would always have my back. And then bam, well, not the stalker. That was, she's not one of those women. But like my cousin was one of them when she accused me of molesting her, which never happened. And years later, she admitted she made it up. It's like, bro, like I'm sitting there like I've seen it with my family. I've seen it with people. I've seen it. It happens. But I noticed that I started getting less betrayed when I became more diligent about who I picked and chose. So as an example, like recently I blocked like Lav and Mr. Girl, which I don't mind being open about. I've talked to them both publicly. But like I blocked Lav right away when she started talking shit on me with Mr. Girl. Because you're too old now and you're too immature to be trusted. You're both. You're too old, you should know better, but you're so immature you can't be trusted because you're not smart enough to make good decisions. So now, to save myself, I have to block her without remorse or sympathy because she had so many chances. We all gave her so many chances and she's failed the test. And so now, respectfully, we have to bully her out of our circles. I have to. And tell her, no. Even if you want to contact me, even if you want this, like, no, you've already had your chances. And the moment you lied about me on stream, that was it. And now for my own safety, I can't give you any more. But if someone in my inner circle did something like this to me, I'd probably give them 1,000 chances. I'd be like, okay, are you done lying? No. I'll wait until you turn around like everyone else. You know what I mean? But Lav doesn't deserve that from me. She hasn't earned it from me. And so as a way to keep myself safe, I have to just simply, bye-bye. And that allows me to continue my high trust existence because I trust myself to pick and choose better.
Yeah, it's also worth examining that, like, the question of, is that a big deal or not a big deal? Because what you've done is basically, you know, cut ties with someone who you have no particular ties with. I mean, this isn't someone who needs you in order to get food. You know, they're not going to starve to death if they're not able to talk to you. They don't need you to listen to them. I don't know. They don't need to communicate with you. Mm-hmm. And so it's a question of, have you done something significant or insignificant when you cut someone out like that? And it's interesting for people like me, you, other people listening, to think about how that feels, how that sounds. Does someone immediately think, no, Brittany, that's wrong. You should give people another chance. As if it's a big deal. As if this is an important thing. Or does someone just think, yep, move on. Like, you know, there's hundreds of people that you meet every day who you do not hand your phone number to. And now Lav is just in the same situation as all those people. Not going to call you. Just like the people you walk by in the street.
Right.
You know, it's not a big deal in a certain sense to just say, hey, I'm focusing on other people. I'm not going to answer your calls. You know, I'm not in love with you. We don't have children together. There's nothing here. It's no big deal. But it is a big enough deal to say that it does mean something to say to a person, I'm taking myself away from you. Like, I value my time and I have better things to do than spend it with you.
Exactly. I think it comes down to that. Like, that's why I think I have so much, I'm so sure of myself because I look at myself and how I've learned. Like, my stalker was somebody who asked me for help. And against my better judgment, even though I told everyone around me we should not engage with this woman, everyone convinced me, no, Brittany, she's helpless. We need to help her. And it fucked me over so hard that I was like, okay, I'm just going to trust myself because I doubted myself long enough. And every time I doubt myself, I fuck up. If I just trust myself, if I have high trust with me, I think my life goes better. And it does. My intuition, even if I can't explain it, really does protect me from people that are dangerous. Even though other people might look at the situation and say like, oh no, it's like you're borderline and you're thinking about it too much. But it always ends up, I always end up being fucking right. And enough for me, enough within my values, enough in the way that I need to be right to know that I was meant to pull myself away. So I think that it does show great restraint on my end. Like even Steven said, Lav could come back into his life. And I was like, holy fuck, what does she have to do? What does she fucking have to do to make you turn around and like leave this woman from your life? She didn't even do that much to me. She just, one little tiny lie. And I was like, ooh, out. But that's because I've learned. I've learned from all my past mistakes. So I don't know how my wonderful friend Steven, could ever think that, yeah, if she apologizes enough, she could come back into my life. Like, no, bro, she accused you of being like basically Harvey Weinstein. That's a fucking huge accusation. That is not a game. And then, like, he's treating it. You know what it is? He treats his life like a game. Maybe his life's not as important to him as mine is to me. Yet I am suicidal. I hate him. I hate everyone who's not suicidal for caring so little about their life. How amazing is that? I need a shot.
That is the way it came across when he was talking about it. That he has gamified his life. And it's how he's very much... Or he seems to be, you know, seeking the adrenaline, seeking the challenge, seeking the risk and the danger.
Crazy. Yeah, no, I value my life so much and I respect the people in my life too much to go back into old Brittany habits and for the thrill of the, ooh, that's a weird person, engage. Like, I still do it to some extent, but I'm less likely now, especially with a partner who's very much like, uh-uh. And I'm like, like, I do. I have that bad thought in my brain that's like, pick up a hitchhiker. But I can't. I have responsibilities now. I can't just pick up hitchhikers because that's interesting to me. I have so many people that depend on me. So you're right. It goes back to that. So maybe fear is better. You have a better relationship with fear when you have enough responsibility, but also you have a different relationship with fear because of that responsibility. Like, in a very strong way, it's almost, I am more afraid to die now because I have the responsibility of a partner, which is interesting. So I, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I think one side of it is that fear feels more dangerous if you're going to give into it. Because you start to worry, oh, not only is this going to hurt me, but it's going to hurt my loved ones. And so you can be more scared and you can be more willing to hurt other people or do whatever you want to do in order to protect all the people that you care about. And you know, you can go down that path. But there's also a degree to which when you really have people that depend on you, you can't afford to be so counterproductive. Like, you do realize that, oh, no, I can't just, like, hide away in a hole. Hopefully, like, not everyone, but, you know, a lot of people realize that they can't just hide away in a hole. That for their loved ones, they have to go out and be brave. They have to go out and trust people. They have to go out and you know, interact with people and do all these things that aren't that big a deal. But you do have to go out and live your life in a way that will enable you to, you know, care for the people that you care about.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm done on my end. We've been talking for quite some time and I have a date to get to. So is there anything else on your mind you'd like to talk about before I go do that?
No, that's good. We made it through the fun part of the book. There's plenty of Oz to read, by the way.
Okay. Yeah. I'm amazed at how much better the lesson was in the book than in the movie. I highly recommend. Also, maybe that's why I like books better than movies too, is I feel like the books, like, unless the movie's really good, which you have great taste in, like, movies in general, like, the books, they have so much, that's just, like, so much meatier and good. I love it. Good recommendation. Thank you for this collaboration, Q. Thank you for being here. If you guys have any comments or questions, leave them down in the sections below, and I will see you next podcast. Okay, bye!
Stuck in my head, in real life I'm in bed, my belly's being fed, and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine, not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed, so why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking, yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth, and living life as a fool. Dun, dun, dun.